And welcome to this e-module on Heating, Ventilation and Air Conditioning Part 2, Chillers. Let's take a look at the learning objectives of this module. By the end of this module, you will be able to understand chillers and why we need them. Explain the working principle of chillers. List the components of chillers. Understand chilled water systems. Explain the working of chilled water systems. List the components of chilled water systems. Name the manufacturers of chillers, cooling towers and pumps. Explain the operation and maintenance of chillers. Understand the preventive measures that should be taken for chillers. List the maintenance checklist for chilled water systems. Explain the impact of chillers and chilled water systems on businesses. List the top 5 issues and troubleshooting tips. Let us begin with the introduction. In the first module, we learnt about air conditioning systems and were introduced to central air conditioning plants. We also saw that in the window and split type of ACs, the refrigerant directly cools the air as the warm air passes over the evaporator pipes containing the chilled refrigerant. This type of cooling systems, where the refrigerant cools the air directly, are also known as direct expansion, that is DX systems. Now, consider a slightly larger facility to be cooled, for example, an auditorium or a floor comprising of multiple offices. In such a case, we will have to install more number of units of higher capacities to cool the larger area. DX units have the limitation on the length of piping that can be used due to the issues of pressure drop and thermal losses, and hence we cannot have one unit serving too many or far away indoor units. Also, the amount of refrigerant being used also becomes higher with the number of units or long piping. The other option for cooling larger areas, large buildings with multiple floors, is to use a chilled water, that is CW system or chillers. Though the principle of operation of various components remains the same, indirect cooling is used. The chiller's refrigerant gas cools water, which is then transported to the various air handling units of the facility and cools the air just like the evaporator does. Therefore, there is an addition of piping and pumps to distribute the cold water through the building and back to the chiller for cooling. In this module, we will learn more about chillers, chilled water systems, cooling towers and cooling water pumps. A chiller can be described as a machine that removes heat from a liquid via a vapor compression or absorption refrigeration cycle to produce chilled liquid. This cooled liquid flows through pipes in a building and passes through coils in air handlers, fan coil units or other systems, cooling and usually dehumidifying the air in the building. The liquid used for cooling may be water, glycol, a mix of glycol and water or oils. For general AC requirements, water is preferred due to less cost, but some processes may require use of other liquids. Chillers can be broadly classified into two by the manner in which the condenser is cooled, air-cooled or water-cooled. In air-cooled chillers, the condenser coils are cooled by a fan using ambient air. The water-cooled chillers use water to cool the condensers, and the cooling water in turn loses the heat gained to the ambient using an external equipment such as an outdoor cooling tower. Now, let us understand in detail why we need chillers. As we have learned in part 1 of this module, HVAC systems, chillers are used to cool large to very large facilities. It is much easier and cheaper to use water than running refrigerant piping all over the building. Chillers are also used in industrial processes, either to provide cooling to equipment that generate a lot of heat but need cool environments for operation, or provide specific temperatures with a high precision for certain processes. Let's look at some examples. In the plastic industry, a chilling system cools the hot plastic that is injected, blown, extruded or stamped. Similarly, in the printing industry, a chiller not only removes the heat generated by the friction of the printing rollers, but also cools down the paper after it comes out of the ink drying ovens. In the rubber industry, they are used to cool the multi-zone water temperature control units of the rubber extruder barrel and also cool the rubber mill, calendars and Bambury mixers. Some industries like pharmaceuticals and electronics require clean rooms where a high level of clean air and control of temperature and humidity are critical to the processes. For larger systems, chillers are much cheaper with respect to initial cost and also have less operating cost against the DX systems for the same capacity. With cooling expenses accounting for 30% to 50% of your total energy costs and rising fast, chillers help in reducing the utility bills of a large facility. Now that we have learned about the importance of chillers in several industries, let's understand how they work. Chillers are used in various air conditioning and process cooling applications. The function of chillers is to cool water, which is then transported to the load terminals and back to the chillers through a network of pumps and pipes. The water passes through the tubes of coils to cool air in an air handling unit, or it can provide cooling for a manufacturing or industrial process. A typical chilled water central air conditioning system comprises of three major subsystems: the chiller, chilled water system, and air distribution system. In case of a water-cooled chiller, another component of condenser cooling system comes into play. In this module, we will learn about water-related systems. In the next module, we will cover air handling systems. The chiller itself operates in accordance with the regular vapor compression cycle as shown in the figure, or vapor absorption cycle as described in the earlier module. It comprises of a compressor, condenser, evaporator and expansion valve. However, there are two main differences. First, the size of the components is much larger. And second, instead of the refrigerant cooling the air in the evaporator, it is now cooling water. Another component that can be seen in the figure is that there is a connection going to the cooling tower, which means that this diagram represents a water-cooled chiller. Let us now look at the components of a chiller. The main components of a chiller are same as those of air conditioning systems, namely compressor, condenser, cooling tower, expansion valve and evaporators. In this topic, we will learn about the types of compressors, condensers and evaporators. Let's begin with compressors. A compressor is a device that compresses a gas, thus increasing its pressure by reducing its volume. In an air conditioning system, the compressor draws the low pressure gas from the evaporator and compresses it to a high temperature, high pressure gas before supplying it to the condenser. Different types of compressors that are used in chillers are reciprocating type compressor, centrifugal compressor, rotary compressors, screw compressors and scroll compressors. Let's have a brief look at them. The first type of compressor is the reciprocating compressor, which uses pistons moving back and forth to compress the gas, much like an engine. It draws in the gas through inlet valve while moving outwards and then compresses it during the inward motion, releasing the high pressure gas through an outlet valve. The second type of compressor is centrifugal compressor, which uses the centrifugal force via a high-speed rotating impeller to increase the pressure or temperature of the gas. The gas is sucked into the rotating impeller at its axis, that is center, and as it moves outward, it gains speed and is compressed as it reaches the outside edge of the impeller blade. The third type is rotary compressor, which has an off-centered shaft with blades moving at high speed inside a cylinder. Gas is drawn in at the suction end And as the rotor moves, the trapped gas is compressed by the reducing volume due to the eccentric movement of the shaft. Screw compressors use two helical rotors which mesh together to trap and compress the gas as it moves forward towards the outlet in a cylinder, with the available space getting increasingly smaller. They have increased reliability due to lesser moving parts and higher efficiency. The last type of compressor is scroll compressor that comprises of two scrolls, one fixed and the other moving. As the moving scroll moves, pockets of gas are slowly moved towards the center, gradually reducing in volume, thereby compressing the gas. Let us now have a look at condensers. As the name suggests and discussed previously, the condenser condenses the vapor into liquid and in the process rejecting heat to the surrounding. The different types of condensers are air-cooled condenser, water-cooled condenser and evaporative condensers. Let's understand them one by one. Let's first look at air-cooled condensers. These systems work by cooling the air directly and dissipating the heat to another location. They are widely used in chillers, refrigerators and air conditioning systems. The refrigerant passes through tubes attached with fins and is directly cooled by the air passing over the tubes. A fan directs the air over the tubes. Air-cooled condensers require a lot of air to cool the refrigerant and still do not lower the temperature to the levels achieved by water cooling. As a result, the electrical consumption goes up for the compressor as well as the condenser. The next type of condenser is water-cooled condenser. In a water-cooled condenser, water is used to cool the refrigerant and then water is taken away to a cooling tower to dissipate the heat gained. The cold water flows through tubes within the condenser and the refrigerant moves inside the shell and condenses over the tubes, collecting at the bottom of the condenser. In another variation, the refrigerant can be in tubes and the water is in the shell. The liquid refrigerant is then taken to the evaporator through the expansion valve. Water-cooled condensers require their own pumps and network of pipes for transmitting water to or from the cooling tower, which is again an additional component. Therefore, the initial cost of water-cooled systems is higher. Evaporative condenser is the last type of condenser, which is a variation of the water-cooled condenser. The evaporative condensers employ a spray of water directly onto the condenser's pipe, whereby some amount of water evaporates, cooling the refrigerant in the process. The last component of chillers that we are going to discuss is an evaporator. As learned in the previous module, evaporators are the ones where the liquid refrigerant loses its heat and converts to vapor, thereby cooling the medium. In a chiller, the evaporator is of the shell and tube type, just like the one we saw in the condenser. The refrigerant could be in tubes, that is dry expansion, or the shell, that is flooded type, while the water will be on the other side. You must be wondering why these chilled water systems are required. Let's understand. The cooled water from the chiller is transported to the various end users, that is, the air handling units, where the chilled water will cool the air being supplied to the conditioned spaces or an industrial process. The water also needs to be transported back to the chiller for cooling again. This is achieved through pumps, piping and valves. Technically speaking, at this stage, the chilled water can be classified as a refrigerant. Chilled water systems can be rather complex and many chilled water systems are found in commercial and industrial applications. Next, let's understand how a chilled water system works. The chiller basically removes heat from the water. It is used as a refrigerant to remove heat from the building. The chilled water circulates through a chilled water loop and through coils located in air handlers. The chilled water absorbs the heat from the building. It then returns to the chiller where the chiller removes the heat from the water using the refrigeration process. Some chilled water loop arrangements are very complex while others are simple. It is evident that pumps will be required to push the water to all the locations in the facility. The basic pumping arrangements used in chillers can be classified into two: direct primary, that is constant flow, and primary, that is secondary system. Please note that there may be additional pumps used in the system. However, we will stick to the basic configurations here. First, let's learn about the direct primary system. In a direct primary system, there is only one set of pumps which is used for distribution of the chilled water to the entire network and bring it back. The distribution is at constant flow irrespective of the load. Walls at the building air handling systems will allow the chilled water to be bypassed under low load conditions so that the total flow through the chiller remains constant. This system is inefficient because of the wastage of energy. The mixing of chilled bypass water with the return water reduces the efficiency of the chillers. Now let's look at the primary-secondary chilled water system. In this scheme, the chilled water system is divided into two distinct loops, primary and secondary. This arrangement can supply variable flow through the system while maintaining a constant flow through the chillers. The secondary loop contains three-way valves to control the flow of water through the air handlers depending on load. However, the overall quantity of water through the system will remain the same. Now that you have learned about the working of chilled water systems, let's look at their components. A conventional chilled water distribution system will have chilled water pumps, chilled water and condenser water distribution systems that include piping, an expansion tank, control valves, check valves, strainers and so forth. As discussed earlier, for water-cooled condensers, the cooling water needs to lose the heat gained to the environment. This is done using a cooling tower. Let's understand how a cooling tower works. The warm water is pumped to the top of the cooling tower where it is evaporated. The tower blows air through a stream of water, causing some of it to evaporate, and the evaporation cools the water stream. Some water is lost due to evaporation and falling outside the sump. Therefore, water has to be added regularly to make up for the lost water. Make-up water also helps in removing the high concentration of minerals from the water which collect due to evaporation of water. The actual amount of cooling that an air conditioning system gets from a cooling tower depends on the relative humidity of the air and the barometric pressure. Cooling water in a cooling tower may require chemical treatment or dosing to maintain the quality of water. Though there may be slight differences in how water and air react inside a cooling tower, the basic principle remains the same. Now that we have learned about the components of chilled water systems, let us have a look at the top manufacturers of chillers, cooling towers and pumps. Top manufacturers of chillers are York, Carrier, Trane, Blue Star and Kirloskar. Top manufacturers of cooling towers are Advanced Cooling Towers, Perfect Cooling Towers and Paharpur Cooling Towers. Top manufacturers of pumps are KSB Pumps, Grand Foss, ETA, Carrier and Blue Star. Let us now learn about the operations and maintenance of chillers. All chillers require continuous maintenance for proper functioning. Here is the list of regular checks and monitoring schedule that you need to follow. Maintain an operating log. Regular checks should be noted for chilled water inlet and outlet temperature, chilled water discharge and suction pressure, set points, oil pressure, current in amperes. Safeties like high pressure or low pressure cutout, oil pressure cutouts, phase reversal protection, etc. are provided. The operations of these safeties need to be checked. Check for abnormal noise and vibration in chiller. For a chiller to transfer heat efficiently, heat transfer surfaces must be kept clean and monitored regularly. Monitor the operation of the chiller's purge unit to identify leaks. Check valves for proper operation. Check for insulation and leakages in the system. Check cleanliness around the chiller. Here is the list of monthly and annual checks that you need to follow. Monthly checks. Check all electrical cable connection tightness. Check compressor motor terminals connection tightness. Check earthing connection. Clean the electrical panel with blower. Check compressor shaft coupling bolts tightness. Annual checks. Test and analyze the chiller's oil and refrigerant. Conduct eddy current testing to check the chiller tubes. Next, we will have a look at preventive measures for smooth functioning of chillers. Preventive measures that need to be followed for the smooth functioning of chillers are 2. Clean chiller tubes, removing accumulations of scale, sludge or biological growth. Chemically, treat the water to remove contaminants, preventing the accumulation of contaminants on heat transfer surfaces. Conduct ongoing chemical water treatment with proper concentration of chemicals. Record data daily for a historical record of operating conditions to identify trends and potential problems. Log data to track chillers. Chiller's performance, condenser water supply and return temperatures, evaporator and condenser pressures, oil temperatures and pressure, drive motor current and voltage. Let us now look at the maintenance checklist of chilled water system. All chillers require continuous maintenance for proper functioning. Here is the list of regular checks and monitoring schedule for cooling towers and pumps that you need to follow. Clean tower, remove all dust, scale and algae from tower basin, fill and spray nozzles. Inspect nozzles for clogging. Make sure water is flowing through nozzles in the hot well. Check fan motor bearings for abnormal noise. Annually inspect bearings for wear. Check the condition of the fan motor by measuring and recording running current. Check and tighten electrical connections on fan motor. Check and tighten fan motor foundation bolts. Repair fan motors or greasing, rewinding, bearing, bushes replacement of motors, start and run contactors, capacitors. Replace fan blades. Check drift eliminators, louvers and fill. Look for proper positioning and scale build-up. Clean pan strainer monthly or as needed. Check water quality for biological contamination. Clean unit as needed and contact a water treatment company for recommended water treatment program regularly. Check pumps and motors of the condenser pumps and chilled water pumps. Tighten all connections. Inspect for leaks. Check all valves in the system at quarterly intervals for normal opening and closing. Lubricate if required. Parameters to be logged for a chilled water distribution system. Discharge pressure of pumps. Frequency of pump if VFD fitted. Frequency of fan motor if VFD fitted. Next, let us understand the impact of chillers and chilled water systems on businesses. If chillers are well maintained, they will operate effectively, which will improve energy efficiency and reliability. This will, in turn, increase the life of the chiller and reduce energy costs. Without regular maintenance, energy use can double in just a few years. Components can fail early and service interruptions can result. All this produces a great loss for the company. Importance on the proper working of chillers is also a concern for the people within the building, as it is an active participant in providing comfortable conditions for them to work in. While short disruptions will not make an impact on the productivity, a longer disruption will keep the staff away from work. Most buildings these days do not have adequate natural ventilation, and hence it can get very stuffy if AC or ventilation is not working. Since the cooling tower may be providing cooling to some critical indoor units like CRACs, failure of cooling tower or condenser pump will have a direct impact on server room temperature as well. Failure of a process chiller will directly lead to a production or business loss as the process cannot continue. Lastly, we will look at the top issues associated with chillers and cooling towers that you may encounter and some troubleshooting tips to address those issues. Let's first look at chiller issues and troubleshooting. The first issue could be that the chiller is not working. It could be due to a blown circuit breaker, faulty or loose connections, a faulty fuse, or incorrect phase connections. To address this issue, you need to check circuit breaker and repair. Repair any loose connections or faulty wiring. Repair or replace fuse. Check and correct phase connections. The insufficient flow of liquid is a problem that's usually caused by pump failure. When the pump is operating inefficiently due to defective components, it can cause the entire cooler to shut down. A fluctuating voltage line is also a common cause of insufficient fluid flow in chillers. If you notice that your chiller is not pumping any liquid or doing so at an abnormally slower rate, you should shut it down and have a contractor identify the problem and fix it. Clogged strainers or filters are common problems for reduced flow. If your chiller is equipped with a bypass internally or site installed, make sure it is adjusted properly. Too much or too little flow being bypassed can affect your cooling process. No cooling. Check if the condenser coil in air-cooled chillers is clean and free of debris. Is the condenser in a well-ventilated area? Anything that restricts airflow across the condenser, or if there is inadequate ventilation, the chiller will not operate efficiently and may not have enough heat transfer to provide the cooling. Refrigerant leak can also lead to low cooling issues. Check and clean condenser coils. Make sure there's adequate ventilation for the condenser. Check for leakages and rectify. Discharge pressure high. Check for air in the system. If so, then check the low side for a leak. Also, check for dirty condenser and recirculating of condenser air. This is a common occurrence when an oversized outdoor weather hood has been installed. Check if airflow is restricted through the condenser. Check for refrigerant overcharge, liquid refrigerant backed up in the receiver, restriction in the discharge line due to physical damage or an internal restriction, and fan motor malfunctioning. Discharge pressure low. Check for ambient air and check if the condenser cooling water is not too cold. Check if there is refrigerant shortage or it is lacking a winter charge. Check for damaged valves or rods in the compressor. Check if fan cycle control is out of calibration. Now we will look at the issues associated with cooling towers and their troubleshooting tips. Biological contamination. It is bad for people and for the efficiency of your cooling tower. This comes in the form of biofilm, which is a buildup on the internal components of your cooling tower. It is treated by shocking the system with chlorine over a series of 48 hours in various concentrations, followed by a complete flush and refill with new water. Corrosion. When the air, sodium, and other chemicals that are found in our water supplies are left unchecked to run through a cooling tower system, they eat away at the metal and will lead to leaks. It is controlled by epoxy coatings, adding orthophosphate to the water treatment or raising the pH of the water up close to 9. Fouling. Fouling is the clogging of cooling surfaces or pipes with debris, dirt, and dust. When water cannot make it into and pass through the fill as designed, the air is not cooled properly. To treat this, chlorine can be used. Fill can be changed and nozzles or other hardware can be swapped out for new parts. Scaling. Buildup of minerals in the water can create layers that rob efficiency. Scaling must be removed or operating costs will increase. Tube coatings, which are made from polymers, are one of the ways scaling is prevented. Summary. That brings us to the end of part 1 of this module on HVAC. In this module, we looked at the need of chillers, working principle of chillers, components of a chiller, chilled water systems, working of chilled water systems, components of chilled water systems, manufacturers of chillers, cooling towers and pumps, operation and maintenance of chillers, preventive measures, maintenance checklist for chilled water systems, impact on business, top issues and troubleshooting.